Welcome to the Library's Research Data Management Seminar, RDH Seminar in short. The seminar is now to begin. Today's agenda, we have three sharing sections from several professors. The first one is location data, extraction and analytics. This will be given by Professor Gary Chan. And the second topic is about data management for experimental research. This will be presented by Professor Peng et al. From Department of Physics. And the third one is big data and analysis in modeling protein structure and dynamics. This will be given by Professor Xu Hui Huang from Department of Chemistry. For three sharing sections, we will have library colleagues to briefly introduce resources and introduction on data management. And then a live demo on data space at HKUST. This is a data repository and workspace services for research community. So now, it is time to move on to the first sharing section. The first sharing section will be given by Professor Gary Chan. Professor Gary Chan is the Director of Entrepreneurship Center, Chair, Committee on Entrepreneurship Education Program, Center for Education Innovation, and he is also the professor of the Department of CSE. Without further ado, please welcome Professor Chan.
Hello.
Yes, it's okay.
Okay. Hello, good afternoon. It's my pleasure to introduce you actually my research and on data analytics and big data at HKUST. Okay, so I guess I will talk about 20 minutes and then leave about 5 minutes for Q&A. So a brief introduction of myself. I'm a current professor at HKUST in CSE department. If you are taking programming course, I guess I might be able to teach you because I'm teaching C++ OOP programming. And so I graduated from Stanford. So at this time, I was working on networking. So currently I'm working on mobile computing. So before that, I was at Princeton working on, when my FYT actually is on optical network. So after that, I joined HKUST, and I'm now the director of Entrepreneurship Center. Many of you may not understand what this EC does. EC actually is to promote an entrepreneurial spirit in the campus. So if you're interested in entrepreneurship, EC organizes various activities and actually give you funding, give you space to do startups. And I think the entrepreneurial mindset is very important for our students. Many companies come to us looking for students with entrepreneurial mindset. So if you have entrepreneurial mindset, actually you're very marketable, because entrepreneurial mindset means that you have leadership, you have communication skills, you're not afraid of setbacks and different good characters. So I'm director of that. And then I'm also the chair of the committee on entrepreneurship education. So meaning that I also look at the curriculum on entrepreneurship, especially the entrepreneurship minor. So basically we design that program. If you have any comments on that program, please feel free to let me know. So my research interest is mainly on smart city and smart space. So enable space. So basically the space around us can be designed to be smart. So what does it mean by smart? Meaning that you know where you are and you know the intelligent surface around you. So that is the smart space. I also work on IoT, Internet of Things, location sensing, how to sense our location, user and data analytics. So this is a bit pale, but actually these are three circles here. I work on three areas of research circling around the data issues and location data problem. The first one is called location sensing. So basically, I want to know where we are indoor. Okay. Outdoor has been solved, right? GPS. But indoor is very challenging. So I'm working on location sensing algorithms. And I also work on sensor innovations. Basically, is how to design sensors to know our location. So how to sense the signals around us so that we can know the location. And now, finally, of course, because we have algorithms, we have sensor, and then we collect all the data. So with that data, we would like to analyze it. So then the third part is machine learning. Learn from your data, and then to do prediction, to do recommendation. So these are the three parts. These three parts intersect at what we call smart space and smart applications. So basically, my research is circling around these three areas to enable smart applications. So first of all, location information is a major driver for smart city. With our location, actually we can enable new location-based application and service. I'll talk about that in a moment. What are the novel applications that it can enable? And it can also create new and immense commercial and social impact and value. So this is, some of my research team is tackling. Outdoor location-based services actually has been around. I guess most of us have been using it. And it's based on GPS. Basically, it's a global positioning system. How GPS works is that you have direct line of sight to the sky, right? About the sky, there are satellites circling around you. And these satellites will give you their information about their distance to the Earth and all that. So based on that, you know your location. So outdoor GPS has been sort of around, has been used by many people with applications such as navigation. Right? You navigate one place to another place. You want to know where you are. It will recommend you the places of interest around you, whether in the park, any hotels, any gas stations around you. Right? So these are actually some of the applications for outdoor GPS. Now, when you think about it, actually we spend more time indoor than outdoor. Indoor location-based services has much larger market. It's a much larger and more lucrative market, which has not been tapped, which is untapped so far. The reason is that we spend more than 70% of the time indoor. And so that is the space everyone is trying to fight for. Actually, Google, Apple is trying to exploit our location indoor. But so far, lots of research are being conducted so to understand our location indoor. Because knowing our location indoor can offer, a brand new set of services to our users. So think of a scenario, right? Let's say one day you are walking in a mall, right? As you are walking, right? You are basically near, some store, and then knowing that you are around that store, and knowing that you like, some brand in the store, there can be some push ads to your phone, right? Saying that, if you enter the shop, you are able to get your favorite T-shirt, right? With a discount. Probably that will alter your shopping behavior, and you might go into the shop, buy the T-shirt, and then as you are, walking around, the space, and at the top of the stair, there, and then you say, oh, your favorite movie actually is around you, and it's almost time, okay, to watch the movie. Right? Would you be interested in watching that movie? And if you go into that theater, you might get 30% off. So in that case, probably you're able to watch the movie. So these are actually one form of indoor location-based services. Right? So basically, knowing your preference, knowing your interest, and knowing your location can give you very timely, targeted ads that is actually will be useful to you. Lots of bargain hunters probably very interested in that application. So if you think about that, actually there are an immense market, okay, on location-based applications. So a survey has been done that it has a multi-billion market which is waiting to be tapped. The first one is the most straightforward, is the most straightforward application is the indoor navigation. So it basically helps you to navigate the indoor space. Usually, users which are unfamiliar with the space would be sort of interested in that application. Where are they? Like airport. Airport sometimes many of the tourists are stranger to a vast space. So in that case, indoor navigation would be useful. Malls can be some of them. Like some malls can be very large, so large that you do not know whether there's any good offers around you, or any good shops around you, any shops that are of your interest is around you. Exhibition center is another one. Right? You're doing an exhibition. And there are some booths you want to visit. Sometimes you are lost in such a big exhibition venues. Supermarkets is another one, right? You have big stores with various items on the shelf, and you are trying to look for a particular item, right? So these are some of the applications. The other one is a location-based personalized recommendation. Knowing your location, knowing your preference, actually would enable mobile marketing, right, and advertising. And that enable what we call O2O business. It's online to offline business, right? Online means that you are online, you have a phone, you have a network connection. And based on that, based on push ads, you visit the offline shops, right? So it's all online to offline business. The third one is knowing the location is that you are able to do flow control and crowd analysis. So what it means is that you are able to know the user's dwell time in your space. Right? Now, knowing that actually is quite important. Think about that. You are in Tsim Sha Tsui watching the firework. Everywhere seems to be crowded, and you don't know where to stand. If someone, some app tells you that, you know, if you go to that spot, there will be fewer people, and your vantage is very similar, right? Or you can even get a better vantage point. So then probably you are able to move around, right? That will help the police to diverge the crowd, and we also try to relieve the crowd condition. So this one point, basically is doing crowd control. In a mall, if you know where your crowds are, you can place your shops much better, and you can also optimize your rents much better. So that is how mall owners that is why Walmart is so interested in knowing the location of their customers. So they can also dispatch staff for crowd control. If there's some crowds gathering in the mall or in some place which you want to understand what is happening, you can dispatch the staff. Another application is called asset tracking. Okay? Assets is what we call variable item. So that item can be equipment, right? In hospital, there can be, some important equipment that would be moved around, right? For example, these heart or lung machines that have been pushed everywhere in hospital, but they are so expensive, the equipment is so expensive and so precious that they are usually in limited supply. So you want to know where your important assets are, right? In a logistic warehouse, the carts will be pushed around, right? So in this case, you want to know where your carts are, right? So these are actually one application. Assets doesn't have to be object. Assets can be human. So one application is anti-wandering. Anti-wandering is that for those elderly, for those people with cognitive impairment, and if they walk out, they probably would get lost. So you want to know where they are, you can use this kind of asset tracking to understand where they are. Patients is another one. Kids is another one, right? In an amusement park, if parents want to know where their kids are, they can basically they can wear some device, they can track them, right? So that can sort of understand where they are. Location-based game, right? A couple of years ago, a very popular one is Pokemon Go, right? Pokemon Go is a location-based game where you want to know your location indoor so that you are able to sort of have fun. And nowadays, malls actually is trying to push out some games like treasure hunting more so as to promote people flow. Social applications. With your location, you're able to know your neighborhood, whether your friends are around, that can basically have a social network there. So in all this, we need to know the location extraction. So the GPS signal cannot penetrate indoors, so we need to have new approach. So inside here, probably you don't have direct line of sight to the sky, so you don't see the satellite. So basically, we need a new approach. And we at HKUST developed two ways to extract user data, user location data. The first one is app, installed on your phone. So you install an app, and that app would help you to sort of understand your location, to answer the question, such as where am I? Right? So I look at the app, I query where am I, so I know my location. So the way to do that is to understand the spatial distribution of signal in the indoor space. So the indoor space signal actually can be anything here, can be Wi-Fi signal. The Wi-Fi signal here is different from the Wi-Fi signal there, right? So by understanding the signal distribution in the indoor space, I'm able to tell you your location. And of course, geomagnetic field is different. The magnetic field, the geomagnetic distribution here and there will be different. So using the minute signal difference in the indoor space, I'm able to tell where you are. Now, another way is to install sensors. So you install some sensors around, and that sensors is able to sense the people. The question we ask is, where are they? Right? So where are my users? Where are my customers? Right? So the way to do that is to understand the signals the users is emitting. Right? So that can be based on the user. If you're carrying a Wi-Fi device, then you are basically able to understand where you are. Right? It can be IP, it can be a video, it can be an infrared. So we have been doing this innovation, and our technology is called fusion technology. So we fuse all the signals together to understand your location. And that is based on fingerprint technologies. So this software has been deployed commercially. If you are going to Harbor City nowadays, you download the Harbor City app. The app actually is designed by HKUST, my Google. So you can use it. Go to Play Store, go to iOS, and then you are able to download that Harbor City navigation. And that will be used by tens of thousands of tourists every day. Our software actually fusing Wi-Fi with other signals on these different mobile platforms is the first and only kind in Hong Kong so far. So that technology actually has been supported by governments through LSCM R&D Research Center. So I would basically skip some of it here. So probably this one first. So the first one is called the app-based localization. So you install the app, there's no string attached, your phone will help you to navigate. So the second one is we install the sensors. That sensors is able to sort of sense the location of the people around. The people can be wearing a wristband, right? That wristband is emitting some beacons, and then you know where you are. Or it can be a smartwatch, or it can be simply a phone put in your pocket, right? So, for example, my phone here, I turn on my Wi-Fi and I put it here, so I basically with sensors around, I know where my phone is. So that enables what we call smart city. And the smart city blueprints is that you can, in the lamppost, you install sensors. And that sensors is able to sense the people around, sense the environment. So with that, then you'll be able to track people around, right? Track the elderly, track the mentally impaired person, track the kids, even track your pets. Right? If you have pets and you don't want it to be lost, then you can use that to do that. So these are some of the mechanisms which I would spare you with this technology. And so our technology actually achieved much better performance than the other traditional approach. The reason is that we are using fusion technique, right? We fuse the signal. So instead of getting just Wi-Fi signal at this point, I get all the signals at this point, right? Magnetic field, Wi-Fi, right? And beacons, if so, and so on. So that's why we achieve better accuracy. In terms of analytics, then certainly we have to denoise, okay? The location. Location always has error, so we need to denoise it. So we are looking at how to denoise the signal so as to come up with a smooth user path. And driver analysis and so on. We are able to understand, using the location, we are able to understand the friendship relationship between users. So we are able to know the social graph of the users. So by knowing that, the more can push a better, timely, personalized ads to you. So I would like to basically spend just 1 or 2 minutes to talk about our deployment and commercial trials. So this technology actually has been deployed, commercialized through two startups. The first one is Compavian. Compavian actually is a startup in Science Park, run by HKUST student. They take the technology out and then deploy it in Harbor City, so and a local hospital. So and the other one is called Sensor-Based Technology. It's also a startup called P-Sense. It basically deployed doing some kind of deployment trials in various mode in Jim Sa Tsui. And both have already have investment there, and they work with different partners here. So both companies actually are co-founded by me and my students. So they have been in the market working with industry. So the first one is the commercial deployment in Harbor City. So you can download the app. The app tells you, just like GPS, in the indoor space, help you to find the shops, suggest the shortest path to the shop, and so on. So that is one application. The other one is in hospital. It helped the outpatients to sort of visit the different department, find the department, and then go to the cashier, and so on. Right? So they can help you to basically plan the routes. Airport is another application, so we have been working on. So some of the demo are here, so I would not show the demo for now. The other one is working with the mall. So the mall, actually, we went to a mall in Zhengwen-O, and then we set up the mall. The mall has 4 floors. So we set up sensors in all 4 floors to understand the people flow. So these are actually the people distribution in various floors. So we were able to track their movements there. And we also generate heat map. The heat map is that indicates the density of the users. So the lower left-hand corner, the red one actually, is the staircase, is the escalator turning point. So many people are turning at the escalator, so there's a hot spot there. We also understand the dwell time, right? The dwell time is that we find that in a particular store, about 60% of the users stay there for 5 minutes. So that's basically users, which is just browsing. And the other one is like 23% actually staying there for 5 to 10 minutes. And there is actually 20% users staying in the shop for 10 to 100 minutes. So basically, that is your customer. So there are some of the demonstration there. So I basically have some press release on that just now. This is also my team, this dedicated team. It's by all means exhaustive. Many of them are in the lab working on the projects. So this is a project. So feel free to sort of, if you have any questions, you can ask me now. If you are too shy, go to my website.
Thank you, Professor Chen. It's time for question. Any question for Professor Chen? Professor Chen, I wonder how you got the business. Did you approach them or they approach you?
Oh,
It's mutual, actually, mainly it's the industry. Yeah, after they know my projects, they will come to sort of understand my technology and start to deploy it. So there's a great need in industry for this indoor location technology.
Any more questions?
Is this something that you patent, or have you considered making it open source and get it to be used much more widely across the world?
Yep. We have patented. Actually, we have a few patents undergoing. We patent in US and China.
Okay.
So the technology has been patented and then is now being transferred to my startup. And now it's been commercialized. So it's not based on open source.
Any more questions?
Any more questions?
The last one, please.
Professor Chen, do you have to pay back to ITF?
Oh, do we need to pay back the ITF? well, yes. Actually, ITF got some license fee. So it's not me to pay back ITF. Actually, through the process, through the commercialization, the ITF got some licensing from the deployment. So, if by the way, my last reason, if you're a CS student, if you're looking for Euro projects, research projects, come and talk to me. Lots of research problems here.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you for